Hello, and welcome to this recording in which we'll keep working with the balance sheet or the statement of financial position. This is CPA exam bootcamp part 2 of 3. In this session, we're going to be working with the balance sheet. Specifically, we're going to be focusing on the asset section of the balance sheet. In the prior session, we looked at an overview of the balance sheet, the elements of the balance sheet, the usefulness, the limitation. In this session, we'll focus on the assets. In the next session, I will focus on the liabilities and equities. This topic is typically covered also in an intermediate accounting course. Now, whether you are an accounting student or a CPA candidate, I strongly suggest you take a look at my website, farhatlectures.com. I don't replace your CPA course, whether you are using Becker or any other course. I'm a useful addition. I provide alternative resources, alternative explanation, alternative multiple choice questions, alternative exercises that's going to help you do better on your exam. Your risk is 1 month of subscription. Your potential gain is passing the exam. If not for anything, take a look at my website to find out how well or not well your university is doing on the CPA exam. Here's a list of all my course catalog, including governmental accounting, intermediate accounting, auditing, so on and so forth. I have lectures, multiple choice exercises that's going to help you understand the material better. My CPA supplementary courses are aligned with your CPA review course, whether you are taking Becker, Roger, Wiley, Gleam. I also have all the previously AI CPA released questions, approximately 1,500 previously released AI CPA questions with detailed solution. If you have not connected with me on LinkedIn, please do so. Take a look at my LinkedIn recommendation, like this recording, share it with others, connect with me on Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, and Reddit. So in this session, we will be focusing, as I said, on the asset side of the balance sheet, starting with current assets. And what's going to happen is this. I'm not going to keep repeating this when I cover every account, but look, this is an overview, really, really an overview. Here's why. Because as we progress further in the course, as actually I do have those lectures ready, as we progress further, each of these topics, for example, cash, investments, receivable, inventory, each of these accounts, I will devote a whole chapter, which is, for example, for cash, I might have 4 to 5 lectures just about cash. About account receivable, I might have 4 to 5 lectures. About inventory, so on and so forth. So in this session, I'm going to give you an overview what the balance sheet looks like. But there are much, much more about these topics in future chapters. Actually, there are whole chapters devoted for these topics. But let's start to define current assets. So this is an overview. What are current assets? Well, current assets are assets, which we know what assets are, resources that the company owns and controls for the benefit of the company. But those assets, they expect it to be converted to cash. So we could always assume that cash is a current asset. Sell or consume within 1 year or the company's operating cycle, whichever is longer. We're going to assume that the company's operating cycle is long. I'm sorry, we're going to assume 1 year is longer. Therefore, any asset that's going to be sold, consumed, or converted to cash. For example, cash is already cash. Debt investments, if we have an investment and we expect to sell it, convert it to cash, it will be current asset. We may not want to sell it if it's not here. If it's the intent of us is not to be here, then it will be somewhere else, which we'll see. It will be under long-term investment. Account and notes receivable, if they are expected to be converted to cash, their current assets, income taxes receivable, inventory prepaid. Those are all accounts that are either expected to be converted to cash, sell or consume within the next 12 months, within the next year. Now, specifically, we're going to see how we value those accounts. For example, cash and cash equivalent, which we'll talk a little bit more about shortly, they are valued at fair value. It means when we list them at how much they are worth. Short-term investments, generally, they are listed at fair value. Receivable, they are listed at something called net realizable value or net receivable. It means how much can we get from the receivable. Simply put, we're going to have the receivable minus some sort of an allowance. So it's called net receivable. It means how much we can collect in our receivable. So we might have $1 million of receivables and minus 25,000 that we cannot collect, the net receivable will be 975. And don't worry, we'll talk about this. The point what I'm trying to show here is the valuation is different for each asset. Inventories, we value inventory at lower of cost or net realizable slash or LCM, lower of cost or market. Prepaid expenses and supplies, we report them at cost. So notice cost is used, but not as much as we think it's used. Anyhow, now we need to dig a little bit deeper into each one of these current assets to discuss them, starting with cash and cash equivalent. So basically, this is a current asset. These are the total current assets. For example, what do we need to discuss or show in the balance sheet about cash and cash equivalent? We need to know what is cash and what's cash equivalent, specifically cash equivalent. We all know what cash is. For example, this company here might say C note 5, and we say we classify all highly liquid instrument with an original maturity of 3 months or less as cash equivalent. So here they tell us what cash equivalent is, and what they can do too, if they have a lot of cash equivalent, they can list them. They might have commercial paper, they might have US Treasury, whatever it is, they would list them. For example, the company might have some restricted cash. If they have restricted cash, it means cash that they cannot use, they have to tell us what's that restricted cash is about. Well, restricted cash consists of CD, certificate of deposit, restricted as collateral for debt services at Bank of America for interest ranging from 8 to 10%. Simply put, we have loans from Debt of America, and Debt of America says, look, part of our deal, maybe they lent us a lot of money. To keep $75,000 restricted, you cannot touch it. Well, we have to tell the investors that $75,000 is not available for you. Because remember, the balance sheet tells the investors what's available in terms of resources. Those resources are not available. Restricted cash is not available. Debt investment. Well, debt investments is any sort of investment. It could be debt investment, it could be equity investment, it could be any sort of an investment, gold investment, invest in gold, invest in cryptocurrency. It's some sort of an investment, but the intent is to sell it in the near future, within the next 12 months. It's listed under current assets. And for example, if it's a debt investment or any investment, the company will show a detailed schedule. For example, debt investments are reported at fair value. This way we know this number is reflected the fair value, and the following schedule summarizes the estimated value. For example, we have corporate notes, the fair value $100,000, municipal bond, U.S. government securities, and this is the $230,000 that ties. Now, this is a simple illustration. In the real world, the company might be a little bit more involved. They might have equity investments. They have to reconcile everything, but this is the basic idea. The next thing we're going to discuss, and again, we're going to talk much, much more about investment in future chapters. I mean, we could have all sorts of investments. We could have hold to maturity. We could have trading available for sale. We don't worry about this now. All we're worrying about now is the structure of the balance sheet. The next thing we're going to discuss is the receivable. We have accounts and notes receivable, and we have income taxes receivable. Again, as I told you, receivable is reported as net, whether it's account or notes. And what's going to happen, the company will explain what the receivable is all about. Where's the receivable is coming from? Account receivable, net and other, but basically net receivable, on our consolidated balance sheet are amount primarily related to customers. So basically, this receivable is coming for a customer. We estimate losses, which is the allowance account based on known troubled account and historical experience of losses incurred. So they tell us, how do they come up with that allowance? Again, we're going to have a whole chapter about this. Receivable are considered impaired and written off when it's probable that all contractual payment due will not be collected in accordance with the term of the agreement. So they tell us here also, when do they write off an account? Well, when the contractual obligation is not met, we don't think it's going to be met, we write off the account. Okay, the allowance for doubtful account was blah, blah, blah. They will tell us what method they are using for the allowance, so on and so forth. So in addition to the figure, we have to show the note. For example, here we also have an income taxes receivable. And the note for this is, as a result of a settled net operating dispute in our favor with the IRS, we expect a refund of $7,000 from the federal government. So we have to let you know, what is that $7,000? Well, it has to do, we had a dispute with the government about the net operating loss. We won that dispute. We're waiting to be refunded $7,000. So simply put, we show the numbers, and if there's any needed, always there's needed information, we have to show it in the notes. Inventory. For some companies, inventory is a huge number. Well, it's not only we show the inventory, we have to show, how do we account for this inventory? How do we value the inventory? Well, first of all, we define inventories consists of product available for sale. We're using FIFO, first in, first out method. We value them at lower of cost and net realizable value. Don't worry about the terminology if it does not make any sense. It will make sense once we cover FIFO, once we cover the lower of cost. The valuation requires us to make a judgment based on currently available information. Notice here we make a judgment, and this is one of the limitation of the balance sheet, is certain numbers are judged. We make a judgment on them. They're not real. we decide what that number is. For example, we might have to write down inventory based on currently available information, likelihood of disposition, such as through sales to individual customers, return to product vendors or liquidation, and expected recoverable values of each disposition category. So simply put, when we looked at our inventory, we gave you this number. This number include our judgment about returns, include our judgment about the value of these inventory today in terms of how sellable they are, a return of product to vendors, so on and so forth. So we give you all information, and this is basically a snapshot, and I believe this is from Amazon. I get this note from Amazon. Prepaid expenses, there's not much to talk about prepaid expenses. It could be listed just prepaid expenses. If there's anything relevant, they will tell us. So this is basically the current section of the balance sheet. Right after the current asset comes non-current assets, and the rest are typically non-current. And under non-current, we could have long-term investments. What are long-term investments? Well, long-term investments are investments held longer than one period. The intent is longer than one period. Because if you look at the current assets, we have also investments, but those are ST, short-term. It means we're going to sell them in the near future. Well, we could have investments that's going to be long-term, longer than 1 year, and we list them in their own categories. So what can we invest in? We could invest in tech, practically anything: gold, cryptocurrency, stocks, bonds. Usually investments are reported at fair value. For example, if it's a stocks, if it's bonds, it's either at amortized cost or fair value, depending on the classification. Remember, those are stocks and bonds of other companies. Sometimes they are called securities. We call them securities. Also, we list under long-term investments, non-consolidated subsidiaries or affiliated companies. Companies that we have either we have significant control in. Okay, and these are treated using something called the cost method or the equity method, and this is one course by itself. But if we own more than a certain percentage, but less than other percentage, if we own more than 20, but less than 50, we might account for the investment differently. If we own more than 50, we account for it totally different. But the point is here, you don't have to know all this information. You have to know that if you have a significant investment in a company, well, you don't buy it to trade a significant amount. You invest in a company if it's a significant amount for a longer period of time. Therefore, it's listed under long-term investments. Also, we could have here fixed tangible asset held for speculation, not operation. So for example, you might have land, building, but it's not to use them in your operation. It's you bought a piece of land and you want to flip it. You want to sell it when the price is right. So you're not using it. Therefore, it's called investment, not called property, plant, and equipment. And here's a section of investments. For example, investments, the company would have additional notes. For example, this company have equity investment of 750, debt investments of 300, and they will tell us in the note, what is this all about? Investment and debt securities are classified as available for sale, carried at fair value. Changes in fair value is reported in comprehensive income. Again, this may not make sense to you now, but it will make sense to you later on. Certain investment will be accounted for using the equity method if the company has significant influence in the equity. They just tell us if they have significant influence. And the company assesses decline in fair value of debt securities and equity investments to determine if such decline other than temporary. Simply put, we have to assess for any impairment. This assessment is made considering all available evidence, including changes in the general market condition, specific industry, individual data, etc. So they tell us also if we need to impair those investments, what do we do to impair them? What factors do we take into account? So they tell us not only the numbers, but how they value the numbers, and in case there was any impairment, how do they account for those impairments? And this is what we do under long-term investments. Another section is a non-current section is property, plant, and equipment, and those are assets that are used in operation, in regular operation, and they're long-lived. It means they last for several years. Examples will be land, building, machinery, furniture, tools, natural resources or wasting resources are listed here. Those assets are reported at what we call book value or carrying value. It means net of accumulated depreciation. For example, we don't depreciate land, and natural resources net of depletion. But the point is they are carried at book value. And this is what they look like on the balance sheet. For example, you could have land, building, machinery, total, then minus accumulated depreciation, and we'll have the net amount, which is 535. So we add them all up, minus any accumulated depreciation. Remember, land is not depreciable, therefore there is no depreciation for land in this number, 120. And again, the company will have to tell us a little bit more about their property, plant, and equipment. First thing, stated at cost. We report them at cost, and that's important. Minus accumulated depreciation. Then they have to tell us how do they compute depreciation, and we're going to have a one whole chapter about this using the straight line basis based on the estimated useful life. Notice here we're using estimates. Again, another weakness in the balance sheet. Leasehold improvement, 1 to 20 years. Machinery and equipment, 1 to 15 years. So on and so forth. So they tell us exactly what they do, and they tell us that they are maybe subject to impairment assessment and using the recoverability of the carrying value test. Don't worry about this. You will learn about this later. The point is, you don't only show the numbers, you show how you account for these numbers, how you value those numbers. Right after property, plant, and equipment, we could have a section called intangible asset. And for many companies, that's a huge section. For example, for pharmaceutical companies, intangible assets represent a huge portion of their assets, more than 50%, way more than 50%. So what are intangible assets? Intangible assets are assets that lack physical substance, but they are used in operation. What are they? Patent, trademark, trade name, franchise, goodwill. Now, again, I keep saying this, we're going to have one whole chapter about those assets, intangible assets. But what are they? What is a trademark or a trade name? Basically, this name here is a trademark or a trade name. So basically, it's an asset that Coca-Cola uses, but it basically lack physical existence. It doesn't really exist. Franchise, for example, if you want to operate a McDonald's, you have to pay a fee to be able to put their name and use their brand. Therefore, it's called a franchise fee. It's an intangible asset, the right to use that name. Goodwill is another asset, and goodwill is created when one company buys another company. I'm going to give you a quick example just to kind of move on with goodwill, but goodwill is an important topic to be dealt with later on. For example, if a company is worth, their fair value of their assets are $100,000, and the fair value of their liabilities, again, I'm using the fair value number, is 60,000. To be more specific, if the fair value is 60,000, we can say that the company is worth 40,000. The company is worth 40,000. If you buy this company for something other than 40,000, more than 40,000, it means you are paying for something else. That something else, if you cannot identify a specific asset, then it's called goodwill. So if you paid 80,000 for this company, and it's worth 40, you remember it's worth at fair value 40, fair value of assets minus the fair value of liabilities, then you paid 40,000 extra. Okay, 80 is 40, so you paid 40,000 for the assets and you paid an additional 40,000. Assuming you cannot identify an asset to assign those 40,000 to, you would say this is called goodwill. Okay, those assets are reported at book or carrying value, net of accumulated amortization for limited life assets. So these assets, some of them are limited life. If they have limited life, they get amortized. And any unlimited life intangibles are subject to impairment. They are reported at cost. And we test them for impairment every year. And again, that's all you have to know is what goes into the intangibles and what categories goes in there. And that's all you have to know for now. Again, this topic is covered much, much more in details. And this is a sample of an intangible asset balance sheet right here. They're listed at cost right here, 389 minus accumulated amortization. Again, goodwill is not subject to amortization, will give us the book value or the carrying value. Okay, and they tell us here, for example, how do they treat goodwill? It's assessed at least annually at the reporting unit, or more frequently if events or circumstances requires it. They tell us what factors they use in impairment: macroeconomic condition, industry, and market condition. And they tell us intangible assets are amortized using the straight line, so we're using the straight line basis. Again, all this topic will be covered later. I know I keep saying this, because I don't want you to think, oh my God, I don't know this. You know, is there something wrong with me? Not at all. This is just an overview of the balance sheet, of the asset section of the balance sheet. I'm just giving you like a sense of what's coming next. And we might have, some companies might have other assets. This is a catch-all category, and it varies in practice. Here you could have anything that doesn't fit under these four categories: current assets, long-term investments, property, plant and equipment, and intangible asset. You could have long-term prepaid, you could have long-term receivables, but long-term receivables sometimes goes under investments. It all depends at what the management intent is. You could have restricted cash in this category, cash that you are restricting for longer period of time. Again, it's a catch-all. It's a catch-all category. At the end of this recording, once again, I'm going to remind you, if you are studying for your CPA exam, to take a look at my resources. Give me a chance. Give me a look. I can help you pass. Your risk is 1 month of subscription. Your potential gain is actually passing. Okay? Invest in yourself. Invest in your career. You're going to study once for the CPA exam. Throw everything on it. My nominal fee is not going to break you. Try it for a month. You like it, you keep it. You don't, you cancel. Good luck. Study hard, and of course, stay safe.